So U.S. stocks had their biggest drop in 5 months yesterday. Do you think we are near the end of the bull market?
I don't think so. I don't think we should over-interpret, over-construe this blip in a normal momentum. So I don't think it's the beginning of a U-turn. Volatility is back, but what happened yesterday should not be interpreted as a signal of a U-turn.
Do you expect this volatility to continue over the next few weeks, over the next few months?
Yeah, volatility is higher than it was in the previous months, and that's, I think, a normal momentum in an environment where stocks have risen significantly. But I expect normal development of volatility that you could expect at these absolute levels.
We just had a nice set of numbers for French GDP. What are the challenges that you see for the French economy going forward?
Well, first of all, the French economy is doing well, just like the rest of the Eurozone is doing extremely well, because just Europe is back in terms of GDP growth and in terms of confidence indices. I think what is even more important than the absolute GDP numbers are the fact that the confidence of all the market participants, of the industrialists, is higher than it has ever been for the past 10 years in Europe. Obviously, some countries have done better than others in terms of structural reform, in particular in terms of fiscal consolidation. But clearly, in this particular country, in France, most of the key structural reforms that had been delayed for years are being implemented on the labor markets, on the tax field, and clearly work is yet to be done on the debt and fiscal consolidation side.
So the president, Emmanuel Macron, is not just lucky, he's actually efficient, is what you're saying.
Well, I think he's both lucky. He is clearly has been lucky and successful in being elected, but he is very determined. I mean, when you look at what has been implemented over the past 6 months in terms of massive changes in the labor code, massive changes in taxes, both for households and for companies, massive changes in the way professional learning is going to be implemented and education reforms. I think he has created a new momentum, a new energy, and it is transforming the landscape and the conditions of producing goods and services in this country.
Last November, you announced the acquisition of the Irish Stock Exchange. So soon you're going to count Dublin in addition to Paris, Amsterdam, Brussels and Lisbon. How is that an advantage in the world post-Brexit?
Well, first of all, the Irish Stock Exchange is a great company as such. I mean, it's a global leader in bond listing and in general in debt products. The Irish economy is booming. The teams within the Irish Stock Exchange are just great internationally minded teams. So we wanted to do this deal because it's a great and natural addition within our Eurozone markets. But it's true that in the post-Brexit world, where clearly whoever wants to sell financial services within the European Union will have to be established within the European Union, because one thing is clear, the world will fundamentally change in March 2019. It's clear that Dublin is one of the few places in Europe, with Amsterdam, with Paris, with Frankfurt, one of those four places where a significant part, not all, but a significant part of the London financial services will have to relocate themselves if they want to do business in Europe.
So who's winning between all these places currently?
We don't need a winner. Each city of those four cities are fundamentally different in terms of size, in terms of proximity to Europe, in terms of proximity to the London culture, way of doing business. Each of them is very different, and each of them offers different features and advantages to different type of business since today based in London that will have to be relocated in Europe.
I'm attending the Paris FinTech Conference later today, where we'll talk a lot about cryptocurrencies and bitcoins. How can exchanges like Euronext actually take part of this cryptocurrency situation? Should we create a market for it?
No. No, we will not create a market because the mandate of Euronext is to power pan-European capital markets to finance the real economy, and bitcoins have nothing to do with the real economy. Bitcoin has a lot to do with Bitcoin. And we believe that Bitcoin is not a cryptocurrency. Bitcoin is at best a crypto asset. All currencies are assets, but not all assets are currencies. And clearly, Bitcoin today is just like a piece of art, just like a diamond, just like a Pokemon card. It can be anything to capture value, but today people buy it because it goes up and because it's not necessarily as transparent as other assets. So great, like good luck, like any asset, like any emerging asset. It's fancy, great, but this is not our mandate to be the place regulated, transparent, open, reliable, to be part to this new game in town.
We're a few weeks into the implementation of MiFID II. Have you seen any big hiccups so far?
No, I mean, we have been, actually, we, as many market participants, we have been extremely focused in getting ready for the big date of 3rd of January. We are happily surprised by the way things are being implemented in a relatively smooth manner. Obviously, here and there, there are some minor loophole where clearly the new regulation is not really achieving.
Does it have anything to do with dark venues or systematic internalizers?
Well, this is one of the issues where some fine-tuning is probably going to be needed, because I'm not sure the intents of the regulators who drafted this regulation were clearly implemented in the way the reality is evolving today. But these are normal adjustments when you do a big bank transformation. But overall, I think it has fundamentally changed the way our industry operates for the better, and the regulators are doing a great job to absorb those massive flows of data. Our clients are really getting more and more ready to be on time, not only on time, but to draw the best from those new regulatory constraints.